Welcome back after the Pentecost weekend. I hope you could relax a little bit, and so we can come back to star formation. I prepared a couple of extensions to what we did in the lecture notes. But before we start, is there anything else that we need to discuss in terms of, lecture notes, videos, contents of the course, talks, and so on? So if you don't have anything, can somebody give me some nonverbal feedback whether my line is alive here? Yeah, okay, cool. Thanks. So we have a shift in the dates, which I think forgot to put online. So initially we planned to have a radiative transfer talk on the 16th of June in 2 weeks. So this is shifted to end of June. So on the 30th, we will have two talks, which means we won't have anything else on that day, which is okay. Again, if you are running out of time in your preparation, if you need more time or so, contact me, then we can maybe shift this around a little bit to give you more preparation time. Okay. Good. If you don't have anything you need to discuss or want to bring up, then we can basically continue with what I prepared. So this is on the section of the star formation rate on galactic scales. So the first is just a very short extension. So we had the Kennicott-Schmidt relation in the lecture notes, showing that there is a very tight relationship between the gas surface density and the star formation rate observed in galaxies, spanning many orders of magnitudes in mass or density and in star formation rate. There are some slight deviations then for very active starburst galaxies, but overall this is a very tight relationship. And there's also a plot in the lecture notes showing that this also extends to different tracers of the molecular gas mass. So here on the left-hand side, we have the luminosity of the carbon monoxide emission, which is then by some conversion method converted into a total molecular gas mass. So from the CO, we try to figure out how much total gas is there, and then we can compute under certain assumptions the mass of the total gas content. And this can, of course, also be done using different molecules. Here on the right-hand side is a figure showing how this is done using HCN. The big difference here is that HCN is a molecule that needs high densities in order to be excited for emission. So here we are tracing only the dense, or observing only the dense gas in the galaxy, which means we are not sensitive to the gas volumes where the densities are lower than, let's say, 10 to the 5 particles per cubic centimeter. And we find the same very strict correlation between now the dense gas mass and the star formation rate, which was also discussed in the notes, that that of course star formation in the inner parts of a galaxy primarily takes place in the dense gas portions. So that's not necessarily surprising. Surprising is nevertheless this basically same strict and very tight correlation. And I just wanted to show one consequence. So to actually come from the top x-axis to the bottom x-axis, we need some x factor. So x factor is the word for this conversion from luminosity of some molecules to total gas mass or gas density. And of course, this factor is entirely non-observable. So this needs usually some external ways to measure the masses, and then we can relate the two to each other. You can also try to do this out of theoretical considerations, but usually this includes a couple of assumptions. So, but when we do this, so when we find a way to convert the luminosity into a mass, and we know how, and we also relate the total infrared luminosity to a star formation rate, we find basically this behavior, and this gives us some depletion time. Because just the ratio between the two is of the unit time. And typical depletion times derived from the HCN observations is in the order of tens or maybe hundreds of mega years, which is lower compared to what we find previously when we had something like giga years. So we are looking at denser gas. We saw that the gas density is of course very important for the collapse, because the denser, the faster the collapse. And when we compute the freefall time, so this was the formula here, so 3 pi over then 32 times the gravitational constant, this is here times the mass of the hydrogen atom, and then the number density, gives us something like 100,000 years. That's the freefall time, depending on the density, of course. So you see this of course goes down with density. And when we assume a depletion time of 10 mega years, this gives us then a star formation efficiency, because this tells us then what fraction of the gas is actually converted, can be converted. And then we are in the order of 10 to the minus 3 or 10 to the minus 2, comparing to efficiencies in the order of 1 that we found from the CO. And the efficiency of like 10 to the minus 2 is also about what we observe in the Milky Way. So this is just again to remind you how we actually get to these numbers, but also to make the point that when we look at the dense gas, we are not too far away from what we observe in terms of these overall efficiencies. Okay. The uncertainty is pretty large. Good. So, in the following, I would like then just to look a little bit again how we just like a little bit on radiative transfer of the HCN molecule. similarly to maybe, I think what I did for the CO already. If you don't have question to the first section. Okay. So, HCN is a linear molecule. It looks something like this. So it has the hydrogen on one side and the nitrogen on the other side with a triple bond. Yeah, so this is how it approximately looks like. I can also show you the, where do I have it? Let me briefly bring up the web page here. So that's an example. This is a database for astrochemistry where we can where information on molecules and chemical reaction is collected. There's also a second isomer of HCN and HNC, which is not linear, as you see. So, and then here they list, for example, like possible reactions in the gas phase and so on. So, but that's how this looks like. And we will look a little bit at the radiative transfer properties of this thing. We will determine the transition frequencies and the level energies. And we stick here just to the assumption that this is a stiff linear rotator or rotator. And ignore all like centrifugal distortion. So usually if you have such a linear molecule and it starts to spin, then the distance between the two or the distance between the atoms changes due to the centrifugal forces, and this changes then also a little bit the frequencies or so. So there are, these are like second order terms in computing. We ignore this here. Okay, so looking at how the energy of a rotational a linear rotator is computed, this is just the rotational constant B times the rotational quantum number J times J plus 1 times H, Planck constant. And this gives the energy difference between J and the ground level state. When we want to have the energy frequency, the transition frequency, then we have to recall that we can only have transitions with delta J equals 1, so between neighboring energy levels. And then we can when we divide this by the Planck number, we get to the frequency and take the difference between this and then the same expression for the next lower J state. So for a given upper J, the frequency is 2 times the rotational constant times the quantum number. So the frequencies are just multiples of the basically quantum number times this constant factor here. Okay, when we collect this in a table, it looks like this. So for the ground state transition from the first to the ground state, the transition frequency is 89 gigahertz. And the energy of the upper level corresponds to, if we convert this to Kelvin, to a temperature, this corresponds to about 4 Kelvin. It is convenient to have this in on the Kelvin scale, because we immediately get an idea on what are thermodynamic conditions that we need for the upper level to be excited. So we need temperatures, gas temperatures of like 4 Kelvin in order to populate the upper energy level significantly. We will always have some population. And the same here for the higher states. And you see that this is 1 times 88, 2 times, 3 times, and so on. So this is in multiples of 88.632 gigahertz. And the energies then go up to a few hundred Kelvin. We can also like use this information to create this energy diagram. So where each of the energy states is shown here with a level, so the ground state is left out. And on the left hand side you see the energy. So when you know we have 100 Kelvin temperature in the gas, you know that the higher J levels will probably be very weakly populated, and the radiation will also be very weak because we have few transitions. Good. So with this information, we can now, when we assume local thermal equilibrium, which means we can just use the Boltzmann distribution to compute the population, compute what fraction of the molecules are in which energy level. And we do this as a function of the so-called excitation temperature. The excitation temperature is defined by the Boltzmann distribution, which describes the ratio between an upper and a lower energy level as the ratio of the statistical weights times this Boltzmann factor, which depends on the energies of the two levels divided by some temperature. And this temperature is called excitation temperature. And this is not necessarily the kinetic temperature. Under LTE, this usually is the kinetic temperature. But the important fact here is that a certain ratio between the upper and the lower level population, because everything else here are constants, corresponds to a certain temperature that we call excitation temperature. So we can express a level ratio in terms of a temperature. And when we compute the population for 35 Kelvin, so we just put in for all energy levels the same excitation temperature, and then we can compute the population ratio between two neighboring energy levels, between J and J minus 1. When we start with J equals 1, the first one is the ratio of the level 1 to the level 0. So 2.7 times more species, more molecules are in the J equals 1 than they are in the ground state. And we can also do this for different excitation temperatures. And I do this here, and this is the plot where we have the population ratio as a function of J for the 35, 50 on 100 Kelvin. And you note that for the first levels, the excitation temperature doesn't make a difference because 35 Kelvin is 10, 20, 30 here. So for the three lowest levels, four lowest levels, the excitation temperature is already higher than the level energy, so we are just in standard, we are insensitive to the temperature, because this number here is much smaller than this number. Okay, so this is how the ratio looks like. When we want to compute the total, like what percentage of all hydrogen HCN molecules are in J equals 1, 0, 2, whatever, we need to sum up all the populations in all levels and normalize this. This is done by using the partition function, which is just the sum of the Boltzmann factor times the statistical weight. And what I do here is, maybe we skip this, this is an approximation and this is the exact thing, because the partition function actually depends on how many rotational levels we include in our computation. And here we show that for a given temperature, how the approximation and the correct, which is the orange thing here, differ when we include only four levels comparing to like 20 levels. This is more like a convenience thing, because it's easier to compute this and much less time consuming compared to this, just numerically. But yeah, and let's just we ignore this here. So, and with this, we then can compute the exact populations, and we could also compute the exact emissivities of the gas. And this is now a section. I just continue, and if you have a question, just interrupt me. Write something in the chat. I try to be attentive here. And this is an example how we can use observations to derive then, for example, because the excitation temperature is like a local condition. It can only be, what we observe is always an intensity. But the intensity is basically a function of the excitation temperature and the optical depth, and a little bit, of course, of the background radiation. But when we ignore this, so we observe this, and we would then try to derive the excitation temperature and maybe the optical depth. So we can like rearrange this here. So this is called the detection equation, because for a given background and for a given emissivity and a given optical depth, we compute what we observe. And let's assume that here in one source we observe these two intensities or brightness temperatures, and in the second source we observe these two. And we can write down the theoretical ratio, line ratio for the excitation, for the line intensities, just putting in the detection equation. And from this ratio, we can then derive the excitation temperature. So, and we can also figure out whether the lines are optically thin. So when we, for example, ignore the background and assume that the excitation temperature for the two molecules is the same, which is usually a reasonable assumption, and we assume that the that the taus are both smaller than 1, or that the taus are both optically thick, then we can figure out the excitation temperature. So if both lines are optically thin, then the ratio between our observations should correspond to the elemental ratio between the HCN and the H13CN. Because in all other aspects, also where the energy levels are, they are basically the same. And if the one is like 50 times less abundant, the intensity ratio should reflect the elemental ratio. If both lines are optically thick, then the ratio between the two should correspond to the excitation temperature ratio, because optically thick means this one here is basically zero and the radiation between the two in the Rayleigh-Jeans approximation, so this can be converted into a temperature ratio. And when we assume this has the same excitation temperatures, the ratio should be 1. And we see that the ratio is not 1. So this case can be excluded. And if we look at the first ratio, this is 50. Is 123, which is like larger than the elemental ratio, which should be in the order of 50 or 60. So, which means both lines are optically thin. In the second source, the ratio is 3, which then indicates that this line here is optically thick and this line is optically thin. And when we then make the assumption that they have the same excitation temperatures, the frequencies are the same, and from this then of course the underlying intensities, the emissivities are the same, and we have no background, then we can compute the optical depth of the HCN, which is much larger than 1. And from when we have the tau, we can now from this equation compute the excitation temperature. So taking the Boltzmann equation and then just rearranging this, and we get something like 28 Kelvin, which is warm, dense gas. So that's reasonable. So this is how from some observed brightness temperatures we can try to figure out local excitation temperatures. And we saw here that this is basically close to the brightness temperature. So when it's optically thick, the brightness temperature and the excitation temperature are basically the same in this frequency regime. So the intensity gives us the direct information on the temperature of the gas and if it's optically thick. Okay. Good. So that was basically a second loop to what we already did for the observation of the molecule of the interstellar medium. Then we had in the beginning today, I had here this slide. On the slide, basically these steps that we, in order to get basically the star formation rate here on the left hand side, we need what we observe is the luminosity in the infrared, so basically the luminosity of the dust, which is heated by UV radiation from young stars. And then from this we can conclude on the star formation rate. So we need, this is the observable here, and this is the quantity, the star formation rate that we derive. And we briefly also discussed in the lecture that this, of course, includes a couple of assumptions, because the number of stars, for example, that produce UV radiation is not a constant. In particular, if we at some point start our star formation with a starburst, and then at some points the stars die in a supernova, so this is a variable with time. Sorry. And one way to get an idea of this conversion ratio is also to look at the stellar population evolution codes, starburst 99, and where we put in like a certain initial mass function, a star formation rate, and compute what is the luminosities that we observe. And so from theoretical simulations, we get basically a ratio between the infrared luminosity and the star formation rate, which we know because this is a parameter of the model. And we can compare this then with what we derive observationally. So for example, when you use the starburst code with two different IMFs, and then you can like look at how does the ratio between the luminosity and the star formation rate change with time. So after 10 mega years, 100 mega years, and so on. And you see that this number changes basically by a factor in the order of 2. Originally given here by Kennicott was a number of 4.5 times 10 to the minus 44. So like a So this is a factor of 10 higher. So we have to like take the ratio between the luminosity and the star formation rate. So we have, this is minus, this was correct, because then the inverse is basically this number, so we are here in this range. So the stellar evolution code gives, first of all, the correct order, so we are at the correct magnitude, and then within a factor of 2 also the same number here, which is nice. And to show you here, this ratio changes with time, of course, because at some point here after 5-6 mega years we get the first supernova of the first generation of stars, so that a new equilibrium will establish. And this is basically shown here in this code. And the second curve shows you how a different IMF, a different initial mass function, influences this ratio. So this is like a 20 or 30% difference, I would say. 36 is the exact number. Okay. So again, we have many assumptions that go into the derived quantities. Nevertheless, the Kennicott-Schmidt relation is very tight and surprisingly tight over many orders of magnitude. Okay. if you don't have questions on that, then I have a last section that is now more, significantly more theoretical. We were looking in the lecture in the section on the instability. What if we have like an infinitely extended medium? We were looking at the genes mass. So what are, when does this medium become gravitationally unstable? When we look at a certain subvolume, for example, and how do perturbations that we put on the system behave? Do they grow or do they just even out? So is it stable? Under what conditions is this stable and unstable? And here in this section, I basically do something similar now in a particular geometry. The geometry is a uniform, infinitely thin disk of gas. Because star formation takes place in spiral galaxies. They are basically thin disks of gas and stars. And they rotate. So we have a rotating system, which means when we look at the momentum of gas volumes, we have basically two additional elements, namely Coriolis and centrifugal forces that constrain the fluid movement, the fluid motion, and can either inhibit or also force instabilities. And this will depend on the angular speed of our rotating disk. So when we take our fluid equations, we have the continuity equation, so conservation of mass here. So what we do is we go in a cylindrical coordinate system, and we integrate along the c-axis all the matter. So we are basically we are in polar coordinates now. So we are only in the c equals zero plane. The pressure is basically the vertically integrated pressure and is expressed in units of the surface density, which is the, like when you have a disk and integrate vertically, what you get is the surface density times the sound speed squared. And we are now in a co-rotating coordinate system. And under these conditions, our equations of motion look like this. So in the mass equation, we had here the density, and this is now the surface density. So this the integral in c direction. And this is the density flux, basically. Then we have the momentum equation, where we have here the pressure term. So pi again is the pressure, and this is the gravitational potential, so gravity force, and we have these two additional terms due to the rotating coordinate system. So we have here the Coriolis force, and we have the centrifugal force terms. And we have the Poisson equation with the delta function here taking care of that we are in this infinitely thin disk. So on this system, we would now like to perform a stability analysis, because we now have the rotation of the system. and this will influence our stability. Okay, so again, in this stability analysis, we start with a assumed stable configuration. So we have some solution of the system, which we call sigma naught and phi naught. So some initial surface density distribution and gravitational potential that basically solves these three equations. And in which the gas is in equilibrium. So that means we have no systematic flows. And on this system, we now add a small perturbation, epsilon, which is a very small number, times some additional surface density term, and we do this for the velocity field and the gravitational potential. So we can just now insert these perturbed terms here into our equation and first of all get rid of everything that is not linear in epsilon, with the argument that if it's like depending on epsilon to the power of 2 or so, then this is quantitatively so small that we can just ignore it. So just inserting this here in the continuity equation, we can then find this term. And what we did here is we got rid of everything where we multiply the epsilon term with another epsilon term. We make use of the fact that sigma naught is the stability configuration, so its time derivative is zero. So this is zero. And we also say it's also constant in space. So the gradient of sigma naught is also zero. And the velocity field and sigma 1 are not constant in space. So that's why we have here basically the two gradient terms here left. And of course, the time derivative of the perturbed density field, or of the perturbation, density perturbation. When we look at the second equation and insert our terms here, this is what we get. And again, we can simplify this. We can, for example, make use of the fact that when we insert here the unperturbed field, so this is this equation here, then we can basically cancel out, we can strike out all these terms here from our equation, because this equals this, so we can get rid of this on the left and then the right hand side. And if we then also drop everything of order epsilon square, this is our momentum equation for the perturbations. Yeah, and this is the same for the Poisson equation. Again, making use that the left-hand side and the right-hand side of the unperturbed equation are equal, and so they cancel out. Okay, so these are the perturbed equations. And then as we did in the instability section, we make some Fourier ansatz. So we describe the sigma 1 we had, because we now have to like put in some explicit algebraic form, and we say, okay, this can be described by basically a wave with this form. So we have some wave vector k and some frequency, and we have an amplitude. And here we basically align our coordinate system such that the wave vector k for this mode is in the x direction. The ansatz for the gravitational potential looks similar, with the exception that we in the exponential subtract the absolute k times c. Let's take this just as a given, so it can be shown that this need to have this form, so we just take this here as given. And we can, when we insert this now in our equation, we can basically find relations between the gravitational potential and the density distribution. So we start by plugging this into the Poisson equation. So here I insert basically just these two terms into the Poisson equation. And so first we try to get rid of the delta term, which means that we integrate the left and the right hand side over the c coordinate over a certain range minus and plus zeta. And then we take the limit towards zeta approaching zero, so that we get to our infinitely thin disk. So this is the Laplace operator here, and we have the exponential term. This is the amplitude is a constant, so it can be put in front of the integral, and on the right hand side. This doesn't depend on c, so it's all in the front, and we just integrate over our delta function, and this integral then is of course 1. So we just have to bother now with the left hand side, and we can get rid of the first two terms. And then take the limit so that only the c term remains. And when we integrate this, one of the derivatives vanishes, and we have basically the upper minus the lower limit. So this is here the antiderivative of this integrand. And this leaves us with minus 2 times k times the amplitude of our potential. On the left-hand side, we have basically this. So we have a direct relation between the amplitude of our gravitational potential and the amplitude perturbation and the amplitude of our density perturbation, which is, of course, as expected. Okay. So we know now make the same for the velocities, where we have basically a component in, so a velocity amplitude of the perturbation in X and in Y direction within our disk. And we start by rewriting the terms that involve the equilibrium velocity using a Taylor series. So we are in a co-rotating frame. And X, so this is centered on our coordinate system, and X is basically the distance from the center. So the in the lap frame, the velocity is given by this equation. And in the co-rotating frame, at the distance r, we have here this rotation velocity. So it means we can write down the v naught just in terms of the omega naught term. So we expand the omega as in a Taylor series as a function of distance from our center, so we can write this just as the angular velocity times the distance, and which means we can write down here the equation of mass conservation can be written like this, and which means when we insert everything, we get this system here. So I will move through this not in detail. If you're interested, try to follow the steps by yourself and maybe also discover some typos or errors that I made here. And we can write down the two components in X and in Y so that means we now have an equation for our sigma naught and an equation for the two velocity components, and we can now combine these three equations and solve them. So this is here. Not sure this is at RV2 omega naught. Should this here? Should this be? So we can, this is just a matrix of the coefficients here in front of sigma VAX, VAX and VAY. The right hand side needs to be zero, and to solve this we need to compute the determinant, which for a 3x3 matrix can be written down just analytically. So it gives us this equation, and when we rearrange this, we come here to this dispersion relation for our rotating thin disk, where it relates basically the omega from our perturbation with the rotation term and the density. And from applications, for example, of the damped and the driven oscillator, you already know that depending on whether this number is larger or smaller than zero, you have either growing or diminishing oscillations. Um, And this, of course, depends on what numbers we actually put in here. And this can be collected into this tumre parameter Q. That then, depending if it's smaller than one or larger than one, distinguishes between an omega squared larger or smaller than zero. So when we start with this dispersion relation and are looking at instability, so we have a negative omega squared, so that we have this imaginary part in our perturbation, and so this is the equation, and we can rearrange this so we look at the minimum value of this quadratic equation. So this is quadratic in K, and the smallest possible value in K is here. So I also did this here with in Mathematica just as a nice example, and we see then that we find the same where is it? We find this the same condition here. Okay. So when we plug in this minimum in our equation, so inserting this value for k squared and for k, then we will have instability only if this is larger or smaller than zero. So from this condition, we can basically we find that this ratio needs to be zero, smaller than one, and so we basically abbreviate this with Q. So this depends basically on the rotation speed of our galaxy. The pressure and the surface density distribution. Everything else is constant. So when the sigma is larger or is growing, this whole thing is becoming smaller. So this is higher density are working towards instability. On the other hand, if we rotate our disk faster, Q grows and it will stabilize our gas, which makes sense because we have additional centrifugal forces driving everything apart. Okay. And from this we can also, like, for an unstable mode, K tumre, let's say this is unstable, and the wave number corresponds basically to a length scale, and from this is the length scale for which the gas, the material in the disk is becoming unstable, and this specifies basically a volume or like a surface here. When we multiply this with the surface density and just take this lambda squared, we get the corresponding mass enclosed in this area here, and that's then a characteristic mass at which material in the disk for a given rotation becomes unstable. So this should be T, and when we put in some typical just stability, so let's say this is stable and we have a certain surface density and a certain pressure or temperature of the gas or sound speed, then we can compute the corresponding mass, and that's in the order of 10 to the 7 solar masses. So that's the amount of gas mass that remains stable under these conditions, because Q is about 1. So again, here we use just the from the Fourier wave number and convert it into spatial scales that can remain stable or are at the brink of becoming unstable. Okay, good. So, the interesting part is here basically to get an idea on how this Toomer parameter is basically derived, and how in a disk we also have to consider like the rotation speed when we are when we want to figure out whether the gas in the disk is stable or unstable. So that's very important when we look at star formation in external galaxies, of course, because there we are making global global conclusions on the stability or instability of the gas. And so, I know this is very fast. I upload the document as always, and then you can look through this and work through this if you are interested, or if this comes up in a later point, you have something as an initial reference here. So if you don't have any questions, the lecture notes for the next section are online, and the videos should also be online. I'm not sure whether I already uploaded the Q&A video. I will check that and make sure that it's uploaded. I recorded this also and will put it also online. So next week there is not yet a talk, but the next talk is then in 3 weeks, so for the coming 2 weeks we have just regular procedure as we had in the previous weeks. Good. So with thanks, with this I would like to thank you, and if you don't have any questions, take care, have a look at the notes, study carefully, and then we will see you again in next week. Okay. Bye-bye.